bow our heads in prayer. Gracious and merciful Father, we approach your throne of grace on this Sabbath morning, Lord, thanking you for sparing our lives through the night and bringing us safely to worship thee this morning. We're asking for your continued presence among us as we study these truths. May we incorporate them into our lives that we will become disciples that you would have us to be. Bless us to this end in the precious and holy name of Jesus. Amen. Well, we're studying lesson number 10, discipling the nations. And our memory text is taken out of Isaiah 56:7. Even them will I bring to my holy mountain and make them joyful in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and their sacrifices shall be accepted upon mine altar. For mine house shall be called a house of prayer for all people. This is Isaiah saying this, that Isaiah again refers to the glorious ingathering of the Gentiles. Had Israel been faithful, men from all nations would come to Jerusalem to worship God. In Acts 10:28, it says, then he said unto them, you know how unlawful it is for a Jewish man to keep company with one with or go to one another's nation, but God has shown me that I should not call any man common or unclean. Here we're talking about Peter. Okay? Now, in the opening up the lesson here, so it's about the, pardon me. Okay, as Seventh-day Adventists, I'm reading here in the bottom, we especially see this call in Revelation 14:6. Then I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach unto them that dwell on the earth, to every nation, kindred, tongue, and people. Then we start off with the prophets foretold. Prophets were told that and the question is asked, what do these verses teach us about universal outreach and about how limited some of Israel were in understanding it? Israel's commission was to broadcast God's universal invitation to surrounding nations. Israel's missionary passion was derailed by earthly concerns. The grand vision was buried beneath complacency. Christ's coming resurrected that vision, at least for some. Now, could someone read for me Micah? Okay, while you're looking for Micah, I'll read your hearing Isaiah 56:6-8. Good morning. Also the sons of the foreigner who joined themselves to the Lord to serve him and to love the name of the Lord, to be his servants. Everyone who keeps from defiling the Sabbath and holds fast my covenant, even them I will bring into my holy mountain and make them joyful in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and their sacrifices will be accepted on my altar. And once again, for my house shall be called a house of prayer for all nations. The Lord God, who gathers the outcasts of Israel, says, yet I will gather to him others besides those who are gathered with him. You remember that Israel was to be what an example or to the surrounding nations of what God can do if you remain faithful. And too often, you know, when you're given a task to do, you think it only applies to you and not and your kind. And this is what Israel fell into. And can you say that we are in danger of doing the same thing today? Any examples of that? Yeah, we are in danger of doing the same thing, getting bogged down in Adventism. If you don't meet the standards that we have set up in our mind, then you can't be a part of this group. And we don't come right out and say that, but by our actions and how we treat others, we demonstrate it. Micah, you have that? Can you turn that on for her?
Test, yes. Okay. But in the last days it shall come to pass that the mountain of the house of the Lord shall be established in the top of the mountains, mm-hmm. and it shall be exalted above the hills, and people shall flow unto it. And many nations shall come and say, come and let us go up to the mountain of the Lord and to the house of the God of Jacob, and he will teach us of his ways, and we will walk in his paths. For the law shall go forth of Zion, and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem.
Amen. Okay. So what do you see in this verse? What is it saying to you? Anybody? The invitation is open to everyone, right? That the mountain of the Lord, of course, you know, just physically, Jerusalem was up high. It was up at 2,600 feet elevation, and the temple was really the largest structure there. During Solomon's time, I don't know how it was during time of Christ, because the structure wasn't the same magnificent and beautiful structure that was when Solomon built his temple. But anyway, they would go up to the temple. Now, of course, we know that Israel did not fulfill its responsibility, but still, won't that be fulfilled in the end? Because in Revelation, what comes down? The holy city. The holy city of what? Jerusalem. Called Jerusalem. So, in a sense, that will be fulfilled. Okay. Okay. You have anything you want to add there? Oh, I thought you were going to receive some. Okay. The next in Jonah 3:7-10. Well, you know the story of Jonah. I think Jonah was what? He was commissioned to go to Nineveh. Nineveh was a foreign country, right? A sinful place, and he did not want to go. And of course, we know that we won't go into the details of what happened to him, but anyway, when he did go, his preaching resulted in what? Pardon? Repentance, right? And the king, even though this was kind of a pagan thing of you know, when for foreign gods, you know, when they were trying to appease the gods, you know, they covered the animals and all that. So he carried part of that over into his repentance of, animals and everything had to repent, I guess, or be in sackcloth. But, you know, it is interesting that this is probably, I heard one commentator say, this was probably one of the biggest evangelistic services in the history of the whole city, or the whole city. And it was quite a large city at the time. They all repented. And because of their repentance, they were what? They were spared, right? Now, what was Jonah's attitude after that? So, anyways, when he was in the belly of the fish for 3 days, was he not spared? He was spared, right? But he could not transfer that over to the Ninevites. So, what lesson is it for you and I then? There. Yes, but then God is no respecter of persons either. You know, he's going to restore his mercy to all mankind. So I said, what I said here was salvation was for all people. And the Jews were given the commission to tell all nations, but they fixed their hopes upon worldly greatness and followed the ways of the heathen. And this, I see this happening really today in the church. You know, it's gradualism, you know, where we start accepting certain practices and under the pretense of being, you know, accepting. And there's nothing wrong with being, you can accept people, but you don't accept the wrong. You should be able to help them to see what is right and not compromise. And I think this is what we do a lot of times today. Okay? And woe unto thee. Someone look at to read Matthew 11, 20 to 24. And while you're looking for that, Christ wanted his own people, those who had so many advantages, to wake up to their true calling and purpose as a people. Salvation, even for the chosen nation, was not something that a person was born to. Now, because you're a fifth, sixth, seventh generation Adventist, that does not give you license. You have no more advantage other than you've been experienced or you've been exposed. But that's right, you should know better. But we find that this is not the case. You have the text, brother?
Yeah, he said Matthew chapter 11.
Yes, 11, 20 to 24.
It says, then began he to upbraid the cities wherein most of his mighty works were done, because they repented not. Woe unto the Chorazin! Woe unto Bethsaida! For if the mighty works which were done in you had been done in Tyre and Sidon, they would have repented long ago in sackcloth and ashes. But I say unto you, it shall be more tolerable for Tyre and Sidon at the day of judgment than for you. And thou, Capernaum, which art exalted unto heaven, shalt be brought down to hell. For if the mighty works which have been done in thee have been done in Sodom, it would have remained unto this day. But I say unto you that it shall be more tolerable for the land of Sodom in the day of judgment than for thee.
Now that's quite a pronouncement.
Right.
Now this is going to the cities of where the Jews lived, right? And they have been exposed to the gospel. So as we said earlier, you know, you and I that are sitting here in church and have studied the Word of God, that if we do not keep our acts together, that from what I understand from that is that is woe unto us. It would be better that those who... Now, when you say says that Sodom, you know, we know what happened to Sodom and Gomorrah. They were destroyed. So how can anything be more worse than that, you know? But that's what the Scripture says, right? Okay. Any other comments on that? Okay, Luke 4:25-30. Got that?
Okay, but I tell you of a truth, many widows were in Israel in the days of Elias, when the heaven was shut up 3 years and 6 months, mm-hmm. when great famine was throughout all the land. But unto none of them was Elias sent, save unto Sarepta, a city of Sidon, unto a woman that was a widow.
Mm-hmm.
One more verse? Is that it?
Yeah, I think there's one more.
And many lepers were mm-hmm. in Israel in the time of Elisha the prophet, and none of them was cleansed, saving Naaman the Syrian.
So, what he's saying here is that he had to get a point over to the Jews there, that there are those that were outside of, or Gentiles that he went to. As is, there is many widows there, but he went out, he sent them to a widow who was probably more receptive, you know. Good morning, how are you? More receptive. Those of us with the advantage of truth need to be aware of our responsibility of the Great Commission. That's what I put in there. That was the answer. It says that what crucial message comes from these texts? Anyone have anything else different in there? Good morning. Everybody speak at once. Okay, look at Luke 17:11-19. And someone look at John 10:16. And when we read those texts, let's try to put it in light of today's environment. Go ahead.
This is Luke chapter 17. It says, and it came to pass, as he went to Jerusalem, that he passed through the midst of Samaria and Galilee. And as he entered into certain village, there met him 10 men that were lepers, which stood afar off. And they lifted up their voices and said, Jesus, Master, have mercy upon us. And when he saw them, he said unto them, go, show yourselves unto the priests. And it came to pass, as they went, they were cleansed.
Okay. So we know that the lepers could not live inside the town, right? They had to live on the outside, and they probably lived in little huts and so forth. And it says that one was a Samaritan. We don't know if the others were Jews or what, but I would probably assume that when you have a disease like leprosy, all the national boundaries disappear because you're all in the same boat here. But he told him to go, you know, from afar off, and when they went, then they were healed. So they had to go on faith.
That's right.
And they went and they're healed, but one turned back.
Can I read it?
And go ahead.
Okay. And verse 15, and one of them, when he had saw that he was healed, turned back and with a loud voice glorified God and fell on his face at his feet, giving him thanks. And he was a Samaritan.
Okay.
And I think what's interesting about this is, as we've kind of mentioned, that the Samaritans and the Jews didn't like each other.
No.
Samaritans are half-Jews. Mm-hmm. And the Jews had a term for anyone who wasn't Jew, they considered them to be dogs.
Mm-hmm.
And so the fact that this one who was a Samaritan turned back around has significance.
Well, you know, Samaritans were, were part of the mixed group, and they did have they did cause them some problems, you know, when they came back to rebuild the walls of Jerusalem. That they gave them a lot of trouble. That so this hatred. Of course, the Jews felt it. Anybody, I mean, there was really Jews and everybody else. Mm-hmm. You know, so it didn't. They had a special hatred for the Samaritans, but the Romans, the Greeks. Well, when they said Greek meant just Gentile or anybody that wasn't a part of it. But we know that they used in the New Testament. It talks about the Greek and so forth. Well, when the Roman Empire, of course, Rome was ruling at this particular time. But we all know that Rome adopted a lot of the art and the philosophy and the architecture of Greece. And the culture, so it became the Greco-Roman Empire. But yet, the Jews still felt that they were better than everybody else. John 10:16, who has that verse? Good morning, Sister Brandy. How are you? Good to see you. And Sister Horsley?
Oh, that's okay.
Who has 10:16? Maybe you need to get two of these. Okay, go ahead.
And other sheep I have which are not of this fold, them also I must bring, and they will hear my voice, and there will be one flock and one shepherd.
Okay. Now, let's look at this text. Kind of straying a bit here. They shall be one flock, one shepherd. In today's environment, what would that mean? Ecumenical, huh? Okay. But they use this text to justify having a one Christian church environment. You know, but that does not mean that. It means that you can be one with Christ. And if you're one with Christ, he says, you know, if you love me, keep my commandments. You know, you don't change, you don't adjust, you don't substitute. You don't say you have authority to make changes, right? Okay. Any other questions on that? Jesus wanted his own people to share the fullness of salvation as some non-Jewish people were already doing. Read that again. Jesus wanted his own people to share the fullness of salvation as some non-Jewish people were already doing. No doubt his words scandalized some, okay, because he preached something that they did not want to hear. However, much of these truths should have already been known and understood by them. You heard this saying sometimes in the preacher is stepping on your toes, some people's toes, because why? He's telling the things that, and you're sitting there, and it's just like I think of the men who accused the woman of adultery, and Christ, you know, he just wrote their sins in the sand. Each one looked over. Whereas you're sitting sometimes, you know, and the minister touches you, and you see each one of us knows what we have done or not or should not be doing or are doing. And we have to make a decision at that point. Yes, he's right, Lord, forgive me of my sins, cleanse me from all unrighteousness, or we make an excuse and say, I don't want to change, or I don't see anything wrong with what I'm doing. You know, that always seems to cover everything. And that's I don't see anything wrong with it. Well, pardon? The Bible begs the difference, but you know, we use the excuse, well, that was for that time, or that's for that situation, but it does not apply today. You know, we find all kinds of excuses, but in the end, you know, we're all going to stand before the judgment seat and give an account for what we have done in this life. Okay. See, what down the question in the bottom here, it says, "What about us? What about all the advantages that we as a people have been given by God? Why is it important first to recognize these advantages, then second, humbly realize the responsibilities that come with them?" And these are questions you can ask yourself. You know, that I said, you know, when you are, you know, I said that being a second or third or fourth generation Adventist does not fit you for heaven, but it gives you certain advantages, you know, that, and I can remember, I'm telling myself now, that I would ride the bus to school, and my Bible, you know, I'd get on the bus with all these kids going to public school, you know, so I had a brown cover over my Bible. I didn't want them to see me carrying a Bible, you know. And one day, I mean, this little girl used to get on all the time, and she'd sit next to me, and I'm not going to tell the story. She was cute. And she saw, when I opened it up, she says, well, you know, you can look at you can cover the Bible up, but most of them have, what, the gold leaves, you know. So she said, "Is that a Bible?" She said it loud, you know. And I said, "Yeah. Why do you have it covered up?" And so I uncovered it. But I was not really sharing. I believe I was ashamed of the gospel of Christ, really, mildly speaking. So it was my responsibility at that point, even though I was in about the 10th grade, to witness. And so I was forced to witness. You know, sometimes the Lord have put you in places where you either have to confess that what you are doing is not right, or just suffer the consequences. Anyone have anything you want to add there?
What about us?
Hold it for
her. I read down, Adventists know a lot more about God's word than other churches, but do we do anything with it?
Okay.
With it, we're supposed to teach other people.
Okay, that's it. You know, she says, do we, you know, we sit here in church and we gather a lot of information. We sit here and we're fed in Sabbath school, through the divine hour, the preaching, through internal study groups, and it all seems to stay within, you know. And because what you're saying is, are we out, talking to our family, our friends, our neighbors? Are we looking for opportunities to witness? And we are all given opportunities to witness. I mean, we should take advantage of that. Okay? And if we don't, it says, woe unto thee.
I had down there as a comment down under there, we can share what we have learned from God's word to others.
Amen. Mm-hmm. Can. That's we are required to do that. Share. Okay. Any other comments? Ken says that on Tuesday, someone read John 12:20-32. We're talking about the Greeks here. And the question is, how is the universality of the gospel message revealed in these verses? John 12:20-32.
Okay. And there were certain Greeks among them that came to worship at the feast, and the same came therefore to Philip, which was of Bethsaida of Galilee, and desired him, saying, Sir, we would see Jesus. Philip cometh and telleth Andrew, and again, and Andrew and Philip telleth Jesus. And Jesus answers them, saying, This hour is come that the Son of Man should be glorified. Verily, verily, I say unto you, except a corn of wheat fall into the ground and die, it abideth alone. Mm-hmm. But if it die, it bringeth forth much fruit. He that loveth his life shall lose it, and he that hateth his life in this world shall keep it unto life eternal. If any man serve me, let him follow me where I am. There shall also my servant be. If any man serve me, him will my Father honor. Mm-hmm. Now is my soul troubled, and what shall I say? Father, save me this hour. But for this cause came I into this hour.
Okay.
Verse 28. It says, Father, glorify thy name.
Mm-hmm.
Then came there a voice from heaven saying, I have both glorified it and will glorify it again. The people therefore that stood by heard it, said that it thundered. Others said an angel spoke to him. Jesus answered and said, This voice came not because of me, but for your sakes. Now is the judgment of the world. Shall the prince of this world be cast out? And if I be lifted up from the earth, I will draw all men unto me.
Amen. Now, this is probably taking place on Tuesday of the crucifixion week. You know, the Greeks had heard about Jesus. This is another opportunity for the Jews to accept him as the Messiah. The Greeks now came from the West. This is at the close of Christ's ministry. At the beginning of his life here on earth, wise men came from the East. So when you say East and West, that means really the entire known civilized world was covered, so to speak. They came to worship. Now, Christ was they probably approached Philip because Philip was they had a Greek name. You know, so you know, you go to folks that you know, and we know that the Gentiles could not go into the temple. They could go into the outer court, right? And so the summons was for Jesus to come out. They wanted to meet him. We would meet Jesus. But it's interesting that the Pharisees and the priestly order and all that were just incensed at all this, you know, because he had made that triumphant entry into Jerusalem. Now, this is on Tuesday. And we know that crucifixion took place when? On Friday, right? But on Thursday night, he was taken into prison. There's a lot in here that he says that except a colonel fall to the ground and die. But now, those of you that are know something about growing is that, you know, wheat falls to the ground in the kernel form, right? That part dies around it, but in the ground, buried under the ground, it sprouts to life, comes up as a shoot and a plant. Keeping it in a bag, you know, in your house someplace, nothing's going to happen to it. So how do we translate that into the gospel? Are preaching the gospel. Pardon? I didn't hear that, but you. Oh, okay. Okay. So. So saying keeping it to yourself, it's not going to spread. It's not going to grow. You know, in fact, it will die, you know, right? Or become useless. But it has to die. It also refers, go ahead.
I was going to say that kind of going off that point again is that, you know, I think of the story of Paul.
Mm-hmm.
Paul would say, I die daily.
Yeah.
And it wasn't until he died, in a sense, to his old former self.
Mm-hmm.
He died to his former self. His name was changed to Paul, and then he goes out and he's giving the gospel. He's bringing forth fruit, and we have all these different, you know, New Testament small books like Galatians, Ephesians, etc.
Yeah.
Because of Paul. So we have to die. We have to give up our.
And that's seeing that one man who stood there witnessing Stephen being stoned,
right.
Who was. Probably involved in the execution of a lot of the followers of Christ, thinking that what he was doing was right, you know. And we can think that we're right, but at some point the Spirit tells us you're going in the wrong direction, and then pride can enter. Well, I know I'm wrong, but I can't change now because of what I think. Now, Paul, I'm glad you brought that up, but you know, he was quite prominent in the Sanhedrin, and he knew that, you know, he had to step down from that position. He had to die to that lifestyle. He had to be humbled. And then he, just think of had he not done that, whereas Christ would have raised someone else up to do it, but it was his privilege to write all those books for the New Testament. Okay, anything else on there?
Go ahead.
I will explain it the way, you know, you put two samples there. When the seeds go in the dirt,
yes,
you know, it comes with the fruit.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. When you, like you say, in the house, you put it in a plastic bag and, for example, they decompose, it kind of comes, the little tree or whatever plant it comes, but it doesn't grow. It doesn't bring fruit.
No.
And as a Christians, we don't have to talk. We don't have to show it in our first, I'm a Seventh-day Adventist. Mm-hmm. For the things you do and how you act, that's how you're sharing the gospel to others.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
And that's what God wants. When you have that touch from Jesus and you put your life in Jesus, no more me, no more I, it's Jesus in me. No matter where you go, you always give that sample. Jesus is in my life.
Mm-hmm.
But a lot of Christians, we say we're Christians, but the sample you give is not Jesus in your life. So I think the key is to die the old I,
mm-hmm,
and let Jesus to be in my life. So I can have fruits and,
amen,
share those fruits with everybody.
Amen.
Thank you,
sister, for that comment. So I'd rather see a sermon than hear one. You know, very good. Any other comments? Yeah. What else can we get from this particular text that you could pick out here? That towards the end, where we talk about his being blessed, Christ. What comes from heaven? A thunder. In the text, what was it? It was the they heard a voice, right? Mm-hmm. It was God, the voice of God,
right?
Accepting. And when Christ was baptized, there was the voice that came, right? From heaven. And when they're accepting his that, you know, his life was perfect, that God accepted that there. That was before he went to the cross. And there were those who witnessed that. Now that would have been, you know, if I was on the fence, I would have made sure I got on the right side at that particular time. But it seemed to just harden the hearts of the ruling class, or the priest and the Sanhedrin group, right? So, and think of...
I just want to make a quick, really quick comment. It's kind of interesting that you mentioned that you would think that an additional miracle or something like that would,
yeah,
soften their hearts, but now oftentimes that's not the case.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that, because I was reading this morning, I was reading Testimonies Volume 3 about the great rebellion between Korah, Dathan, and Abiram.
Mm-hmm.
And even after, you know, Moses prayed and he said, look, you know, everyone put your incense in your censer. And the next day they went out there, and the grounds opened up and swallowed Korah, Dathan, and Abiram. Even after that, the other people who aligned themselves with those men,
yeah,
they still, their hearts still weren't changed. So it's like, even though they saw the ground open up, they saw these men and all their families and all their possessions swallowed up, you would think that would bring them to repentance, but it didn't. So it's like, oftentimes, it's not the additional miracle. It's not the additional event. It's just, it's the Holy Spirit.
You have to be
in
tune, yeah.
And
because you can rationalize away anything.
And that's exactly what,
yeah,
they did. They,
mm-hmm,
they said, well, Moses must have did something, or,
yeah,
you know, it was some. It just, it, they didn't believe that it was God working.
Yeah.
So.
And hardening. Yeah.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know, after each plague in Egypt, right, that Pharaoh, it says the Pharaoh what? He hardened his heart. It's time. Someone have John 12:25. And the question is asked, what was the cause? How do we understand the meaning of this? It says that if any man, meaning man or woman, Jew or Greek, wanted to follow him, they could, but it would come at a cost. John 12:25. Want to have that? Okay, he who loveth his life will lose it, and he that hateth his life in this world shall keep it unto eternal life. What do we mean here? What is he saying? Since you want to say it?
Well, I don't know how to explain it. But, usually we come like I, me.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want to suffer. I don't want to do this because it's going to hurt me.
Mm-hmm.
But when he say anybody who lose the life,
mm-hmm.
So that we come back again with the same thing. You have to die.
Okay.
No more I. Now it's Jesus in my life. But you know, like the rebellion is that we doesn't want to lose myself, me.
Okay.
And I wanted to follow Jesus, but I still want to do the things I want
okay.
to do.
Mm-hmm.
And those who doesn't let it go.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And let Jesus to live in your life, to
okay.
do whatever he wants, those will have eternity life.
Amen.
But the
mm-hmm.
problem is you want to live half and half.
Mm-hmm.
Sabbath, I would do Jesus,
mm-hmm.
you know. But Monday to Friday, I would do what I wanted to do.
Okay.
And that's, we're not winning the eternity life. So we have to let it go.
Okay.
The old me.
Oh.
And come with the new Jesus in my life.
Mm-hmm.
That's how I believe, you know, I understand this. So I don't live more me. Jesus live in my life now.
Okay, you live. So in other words, if you hang on to the material things of this world,
yes,
that they become so important to you that you neglect your spiritual development, you will lose your life, meaning your life. We're talking about your eternal life.
Eternal.
You know, you'll suffer the consequences of the second death, right? The permanent death. That was the one that Christ came and sacrificed his life for, so that if we accept his righteousness, we will not have to go through that second death, right? But you lose your life. Here, in fact, it's going to, the life of a witness, of a Christian, is not going to be easy. You know, it starts with family. You know, that you have family members that might go against you because of your stand and so forth. And it's very wrenching. But yet you have to keep your eyes focused on Christ. And on the final outcome, that if you're faithful to the end, even though you might be persecuted, you might have to end up giving up your life here, as many of before. It says, blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you, and say all manner of evil against you, falsely for my sake. You know, for my sake. He said, because they persecuted the prophets before you. So, you know, what makes you think that you're any different? You know, that we will all, and all of us sitting here, have undergone, and I don't know anybody, you know, I don't know your personal lives, but I would say that all of us here at some time have undergone some kind of pushback because of our beliefs. And it's not going to get better. Yeah. You know, there are forces at work today that are going to bring this, in these last events Ellen White says, are going to be rapid. You know, so we have to be firmly grounded in the truth. Hey, very good. Any other comments on that? Okay, moving down to breaking down barriers. You know that it's you know, when it's easy to work with other Christians, you know, because you do have some kind of a foundation, right? I mean, you believe in Jesus, and you might, they might not have all the light, but at least you have some kind of commonality there. But you try working with folks that are not Christians at all, that are have other beliefs, are very entrenched in some, I think of folks that are in Islam or in Hinduism or these other, you know, it takes quite a bit of work. So when he first gave the charge for the disciples to go out and preach, where did he say go first? The house of Israel. And why do you think he said that? Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, there are, and I agree with that, you know, that there were a lot of, there are probably a lot of, they're all Jews, so he had some commonality there. And there were some that were sitting on the fence, so they, once they were convinced of it, and as you said, Brother Barry, now you got, you've increased your workforce, your army to go out to work with others. And we see that this gospel went, but did Philip go as far as India? Do you hear that? Yeah, I think, but they spread all out. Who was it? Yeah, they spread all out, but it started with the house first. Of course, you know, and then they spread out from there. Okay, so in John 7:35 says, then said the Jews among themselves, whither will he go, that we shall not find him? And will he go unto the dispersed among the Gentiles and teach the Gentiles? So after the captivity, you know, a lot of Jews were dispersed throughout the then known empire, and of course, a lot of them did not come back. They did maintain their Jewish heritage, but they also lost the language a lot. You know, they picked up the language of folks that they were with, in John 8:48, it says, then answered the Jews and said unto him, Say we not well that thou art a Samaritan and hath the devil? Now, these are the Jews talking about Jesus. And as we mentioned earlier, be called a Samaritan was like, Sister Ray calling me a dog. You know, I think I am a dog, but a dog with the devil in him. And this is what they were referring to as Jesus. So they could not conceive of the gospel going or this preaching going to anyone else except the Jews, because after all, they were the chosen nation. They were favored of God, and it was to them that this blessing was was bestowed upon, and everyone else was heathen, and they would be destroyed. Okay, in Luke 10, 27 to 37, it's quite a long one, but it's it says breaking down barriers. And we know that this is the story of the Good Samaritan, right? And without reading all that, can someone briefly just tell me what happens in this story? She doesn't have the mic. Since you're on television, sis, so you got to speak up. Oh, she got mic fright now.
Man sick on the road or path, whatever you want to call it.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody just passed him by.
Mm-hmm.
You know, look at him and keep going.
Okay.
But this one person came by and stopped, gave him help, took him to a place, and left him there and told the man, the people to take care of him, whatever the cost, he had paid on his way back.
Mm-hmm.
What you call a good Samaritan. He stopped by to help somebody.
Okay. So this man was journeying from Jerusalem over to Jericho, probably. And I read that there was the road there, it narrowed down into a real narrow constriction, and there were a lot of caves in that area, and it had been known for robbers to come out and do those kinds of things. So he was set upon, beaten probably pretty badly, stripped of his clothing and left on the side. First one comes by is what? The priest. You know, that's the preacher. He comes by, and he doesn't even go over there to him. Now, you can say he can make an excuse. In Leviticus, it talks about what? That the weren't to touch the dead bodies, right? The priests, they weren't to touch the dead, so... He used that, you know, we can all come up with excuses for not doing what is right. That was his excuse. The other fella, the Sanhedrin, he comes by and he kind of peeks over there and walks another side and keeps on going. Now, the priests and other, they were Jews. And undoubtedly, this man laying there was a Jew that had been beaten. But this Samaritan that is called dogs, that the Jews hate, he comes by, right? He comes by, stops, and the scripture says that he poured oil and wine on, bound up his wounds, put him on his beast, and takes him to the inn. And as Sister said, he pays, but you know that sometimes we're good at maybe doing the initial good deed. You know, okay, and walk away and say, well, I did all I could do. But yet there was concern, there was inquiry. Now, whatever it cost, you know, when I come back, I'll repay. I'll pay the difference. So he was probably a traveling merchant of some sort. So, he came back. So this is, and the question was asked, who is thy neighbor? Who is the neighbor here? We all agree. It was the Samaritan who was hated but yet did the right thing. Now, just in closing, you know, we see all around us in this country, the land of milk and honey, of plenty, there are a lot of folk that are going in need. And you see folks standing on the corners with signs, you know, asking for money and so forth. I saw a family out there. What's your thinking about this? Don't answer. panhandlers begging for money. Do they really? And the question is, do they really need the money, or do they for food, or is it for drugs? You know, you have to be wise in that. I mean, if you see it. Now, I remember one time, I was walking my granddaughter, and there was a man panhandling, and I walked past him, and my granddaughter says, "Papa, are you going to give him something?" And so she gave me the piano key. That's the hook. Okay, I'll save that story for next time. Let's say our prayer. Gracious Father, we thank you for this study, Lord. We thank you for your Son who died for us. We thank you for the examples that you've given in your word. Help us, Lord, to live consistent Christian lives. In Jesus' name.
I'd like to welcome everyone this morning. Happy Sabbath. It's good to see you back with us, Sister Brandy. Okay, I see we have a visitor as well. Would you like to stand and say your name? Albertina De Leon. Where are you from? Oh, welcome to Appian Way. Hope you have a really nice day and a blessed Sabbath. And bless all of you out there, all you friends and family and members. Our song today is going to be taken from the hymnal at 341. The first and last stanza will sing, "To God be the glory." And if you can stand, please do so. Opening prayer. Father God, as we come and continue to worship you and to praise you, we give thanks to you. We thank you for the privilege that we have of worshiping openly. We thank you for all that you are and all that you do. Please come into each one of our hearts today, helping us to hear and to share and to be a blessing to others. Blessed be thy name. Please forgive us of our sins as we pray in thy name, Jesus. Amen. Our lessons this week have been really eye-opening, and Jesus commissions us. And my scripture today comes from Matthew 28, verse 19 and 20. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Amen. God's final work is incomplete until the eternal gospel expressed in the message of the three angels found in Revelation 14 has crossed every racial, ethnic, national, and geographical boundary. Scripture unequivocally states that this gospel will reach around the world. God's triumph and its proclamation are assured. There is no such thing as a loveless Christian. He who is in unity with Christ in word, in life, and action bears the testimony that he has the mind and the spirit of Christ. Those who are truly the followers of Christ love as brethren and are the salt of the earth, the light of the world. Every true believer catches the light beams from the morning star and transmits the light to those who sit in darkness. Not only do they shine amid the darkness in their own neighborhoods, but as a church, they go forth to regions beyond. The Lord expects every man to do his duty. Everyone who unites with the church is to be one with Christ, diffusing the bright beams of the morning star and becoming the light of the world. Christ and his people are to be co-partners in the great work of saving the world. That comes to us from Ellen White's notes that go along with the Sabbath School lesson. And at this time, we're going to have the mission story done by Sister Janice Jones.
Good morning. This is a story of a young lady, a teenager who grew up in Nigeria. So when I say I'm not talking, you know. I grew up in a religious family in Western Nigeria. When I was 16, my aunt asked my parents to allow me to live with her. She promised to pay my school fees and see that I continued my education. This is not uncommon in my culture. Often a relative who has no children will adopt a niece or nephew to live with them. I enrolled in school and settled into my new life. I lived with my aunt for 2 years. Then one day, word came that my mother had died. With sadness, I returned home for her funeral and burial. My family lives in a compound house, a cluster of separate hut-like rooms built inside a wall. Each person over a certain age has their own room within the wall. When I arrived home, I discovered that my father had rented out one of our compound rooms to two young men. As I greeted them, I learned that they were Christian. I was curious why my father would rent rooms to Christians since we weren't Christians. But as I chatted with the young men, I found them most pleasant and courteous. I learned that they were deeply religious and that they held some of the same religious ideas my family held. They invited me to pray and worship with them. I was interested to know more about Christianity, so I went to one of their meetings. I had no intention of becoming a Christian, but I was curious about what they taught. I knew that my father would object if he knew I was going to those meetings, so I went without asking for his permission. I didn't attend every meeting, but I went when I could and was at the meeting when the men introduced the Sabbath. This was entirely a different idea to me, for I thought that every Christian went to church on Sunday. The lay evangelist explained that God had set aside Saturday, the seventh day, as a holy time. The more I listened, the more interested I became. I began taking Bible studies with the local pastor, but was careful not to let anyone know what I was doing. We studied about the Sabbath until I understood it. Then the pastor introduced the teaching of Jesus' second coming. I had always thought that Jesus was just a prophet, nothing more. But suddenly I realized that he was God, and he is coming back to take his followers to heaven. I was so touched by what I was learning that I decided to become a Christian and follow Jesus forever. That's when problems started. I no longer wanted to go to our family's traditional place of worship and prayer. Sometimes I prayed at home with my father, but even then I prayed secretly to Jesus. My father noticed those things and asked me what was happening. "Why are you not praying anymore?" he asked. "Have you joined these men's religion?" I told him I wanted to become a Christian. "If you stop praying and stop going to our house of prayer, then you should stop going to school too. I will not pay your school fees." I knew that my father meant what he was saying, and I became frightened. I had 2 more years of high school, and I couldn't finish without my father's help. But I also knew that I didn't want to wait until I finished school to become a Christian. My father told my school principal that I had become a Christian, and the principal watched me closely. Normally, we students pray 2 by 2 before leaving school each day. I didn't pray in the traditional way we had been taught, so the principal threatened and beat me. Still, I refused. Finally, I had to stay home from school. I stayed at home praying and reading my Bible. Father refused to give me food, so I ate with the lay evangelist. I prayed that God would open a way for me to return to school. The pastor with whom I had been studying was planning a baptism, and I wanted to be part of it. I did not tell my father of the plans, but somehow he learned about the baptism and forbade me to leave the house that day. I was really sad that I had missed my own baptism. Then I learned that the pastor was going to hold another one next day. I decided not to go before my father could stop me. It was a weekday, a day no one expected a baptism. So I slipped out of the house and hurried to the river. I reached the water before anyone else arrived and begged the pastor to baptize me quickly. Then I changed my clothes so my father would not know what I had done. One of the lay evangelists told the pastor that my father had refused to pay for my education. The pastor asked the lay evangelist to get my father to write a letter giving permission for someone else to pay my school fees. The missionary suggested that we fast and pray before we asked my father about the letter. For 3 days we fasted and prayed. Then the lay evangelist approached my father. He explained that Adventists had a good boarding school where I could finish my education if he would agree to send me there. Miraculously, my father agreed to let me go. I was so happy. I was still worried about my school fees. I knew that I could never afford to pay, and surely my father would not pay. Then I learned that the local conference would pay my school fees so I could finish high school. My younger brother sometimes communicates with me, and I tell him about God. My prayer is that he and my father will listen to God's voice and answer when he calls. Your mission offering support lay evangelists such as the 2 young men who led me to Jesus. The offerings support the school I am attending and make it possible for me to complete my education. Thank you for sharing with those you have never met. Can we have the 2 deacons to come up for the offering? Father God, we thank you for this beautiful Sabbath day. And as we give our offering, Fathers, let us remember that everything that we give will be used to your name, honor, and glory, that you will be able to tell others about your soon coming. There are people who want to know but don't have the way yet, but if with the funds, it'll be possible for them to know. We ask you to bless each person here and bless our pastor and Sister Burrow. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Concludes Sabbath school. Please remain seated and we will be singing with Sister Hunter.
Good morning, Sabbath School members. Are you happy in the Lord this morning? Glad to be in His presence? Okay, let us get ready to praise Him and lift our voices together as we sing number 246, Worthy is the Lamb. 246.
Glory.
Let's try number 253. And while we're doing that, if you have a favorite, get it ready. 253. 253. Stanzas 1, 3, and 5. There's
first announcement here, sister.
This is just a reminder for the young ladies' ministries, staff, and members alike. Tomorrow morning at 11 o'clock, we have our session, and we have something special. We have a guest speaker for tomorrow morning. So please be on time, and until then, have a wonderful Sabbath.
Good morning, church. Just a reminder of the pre-quizorama that our youth and young adults are participating in. It will be held March 29th at 4 p.m. at the Pittsburgh SCA Church. They will have a quiz over Genesis chapter 1 through Genesis chapter 25. The youth have been practicing after church, spending time reading on their own at home, by God's grace, and they are preparing themselves to test their learnings that they have been put through to answer questions at the Pittsburgh Church. The second Quizorama will be June the 21st here at Appian Way at 4 p.m. Our youth kids will not be participating in that one because we're the host church, but other churches will be coming here participating for the second Quizorama, which will be at our church in June on the 21st. If you have any other questions, ages 10 to 35. I will be able to participate in the next two. After that, I will be disqualified. I have reached a certain age. So if you're able to participate, or if you would like to help the kids study and to prepare for it, those who would like to help the kids study, you can be any age. Even though after June 24th I will no longer qualify, I can still help in the preparation of our youth for them to participate in the Quizorama. Have a blessed Sabbath, and pass it on to my father.
Thank you. 35, boy, boy. That was one of the saddest days in my existence when I got over 35 and couldn't participate in Quizarama. Oh, well. Also this evening is Bible study time here at the church after the service. You're welcome to stay. You will be fed if you stay. There's a phenomenon that if you go home, we'll probably never see you again until next week. So stay by, fellowship with us, and then study the Bible. Let's see. Also, an important switch in the monthly fellowship dinner. It is normally held every third Sabbath. But this month is going to be on the 22nd, which is the fourth Sabbath, I believe.
Yeah.
Okay, so this month fellowship dinner will be on the 22nd, which is the fourth Sabbath. Since there's not a lot of folks here at the moment, and folks that you know who normally come or should come, everyone is invited. Let them know that the fellowship dinner this month is on the fourth Sabbath. Any more announcements by anyone? Guess not. Well, I want to thank you once again. I want to welcome all the visitors. Glad you are here. May the Lord continue to bless you.